know, with the death of RTMP end-to-end, it's really left this enormous gap. And for one-to-many streaming, people tell me, well, WebRTC makes no sense for, you know, the Champions League final or, you know, the World Cup final, or very large games, and that's true. HLS and Dash are still going to be used predominantly for one-to-many streaming, but what about all these other use cases? LLHLS and some of the things that are happening with Dash to try to bring it down, it's not working for sub-second latency workflows, and we need sub-second for human interactivity. So any use case that requires human interaction, we need a protocol that does this, and there's only one that's a standard IETF and W3C protocol, and that's WebRTC.
I wanted to investigate, can we build an end-to-end WebRTC streaming based on a standard protocols between both the ingest side and the playback side?
The other huge thing about this is when any technology is trying to be pushed into the market, the hardest thing to push is adoption. How do you make people adopt it? Well, if it's an IETF and W3C standard, any device that says it's internet and web-enabled has to support that technology. So natively now, over a billion devices, probably much more than that, are being produced every single year that support WebRTC natively. You can't say that about NDI. NDI is a great protocol, but can it be used? Is it a standard for distribution for every device to have NDI enabled? No, right? And as a network protocol, trying to scale NDI in the public cloud is a nightmare in itself. So having a standards-based protocol that enables these workflows is really key to the proliferation of the technology. Why isn't it being used right now? Well, RTMP is ubiquitous. It's a 20-year-old protocol, right? And every encoder that we all use, whether it's a software encoder or a hardware encoder, is using RTMP as a contribution protocol. The distribution side's gone away. It's gone away as of the last 5 years, right? The only time it can really be used in a, you know, interactivity workflow is if you have a decoder on site that can decode RTMP and output it to an SDI or HDMI or whatever output. But really why RTMP is still the most popular is because it's so simple to use as an RTMP URI. The interoperability between all the devices is the same. I know if I'm going to talk to you, we're just going to speak the same language, right? This is a destination, this is my authentication and my stream name. Very, very simple. The reason WebRTC is still not becoming a standard for, and encoders and broadcasters aren't taking it seriously, is because that simple way that devices communicate together, that interoperability, has been missing in WebRTC. There is a signaling layer, and the signaling layer is like, hey, do you want to receive my stream? Yes, I do. They create that connection, that handshake, and then the media starts flowing. Every single platform that's out there has been building their own signaling.
One way of doing it, it could be this proprietary camel protocol that I've developed. No, just kidding. I was actually inspired by Will Law from 2019, who had camels in his presentation. I thought, I also have to have camels in my presentation. And I can confirm, it's supremely hard to animate camels in PowerPoint.
Once we did it a few times, we realized, this is ridiculous. We should build a standard for this. And so my colleague, Sergio, Sergio García Murillo, built a standard for signaling, and it's called WIP. This is a WebRTC HTTP ingestion protocol. And we chose that name just because we could use the Indiana Jones picture. Who doesn't like Indiana Jones? But all WIP is just standardizing the way that two devices talk to each other, a client and a server. Very, very simple. Without going into more detail, that's really all it's doing. So you want to use your software encoder, like vMix or OBS, or a hardware encoder like Teradek or Hivision, and you want to use it with a WebRTC server, just use WIP, and we can all play together in the same sandbox, right? And we've been pushing WIP now for several years, and this is the status update from the IETF website. It should be approved over the summer. The actual draft is expiring in September, but Sergio sits on the committee for WebRTC, and it should be approved as an actual standard. And then later on today, Jonas is doing a presentation on media server independent playback.
It's not rocket science, I'm not saying that, but someone's got to do it. Someone needs to write down the specification, someone needs to tell it about it, someone needs to get feedback about it, someone needs to sort of drive that forward. And we sort of created a standard for it, which we called WebRTC HTTP playback protocol. It is not as fancy and cool Indiana Jones references that we can use with this, but bear with me, it's a really boring abbreviation, but we call it WHPP. And it's very simple. It's It's HTTP based, that's the name. And what happens is that you have a player and you have a broadcaster, which is the sender peer in this case. And a viewer gets hold of a HTTP URI to the channel or the stream. How it get that, I will come back to that. It could be with a camel, it could be with something else, but at least he got a URI, which is quite a standard way of addressing things on the internet today. So a viewer gets hold of that. It sends a post, HTTP post, with an empty body, but with a content type we call application WHPP JSON, which, yeah, it's a JSON object. And while the viewer or the player initiates it, it tells the server or the broadcaster in this end to initiate an STP offer. So it actually, even though it's the client that initiates, okay, I want to stream, I want to view, it is the server that needs to create the offer, because the server and the broadcaster is the part that knows about the streams. It can know what it can offer. The viewer cannot know that. So in return, it gets a JSON object, including the STP offer, which is standardized in WebRTC, and it includes some information about the media streams and that. And to send back, and also it gets a location header to a specific resource URI. So now it gets a new resource URI in the location header, and that resource, the player then sends the STP answer to using HTTP put. Again, nothing rocket science here. It's very standard HTTP, nothing really strange about this. And then the broadcaster responds with a 204 created. And now the WebRTC player, it has a resource URI for each viewer, and then it can send all the ICE candidates using the HTTP patch. So, I mean, everyone knows about WIPs. You see that this protocol is very inspired by WIP. So, but why reinvent the wheel? We could use the same approach, both with the trickle ICE as we do with HTTP patch, etc. So with you using this on the player end, this is a very early, this is the first implementation. We have the specification draft on our GitHub. It hasn't yet been accepted into any IETF forums and all that. We presented it to Dash IEF, and we'll see if they will continue move forward with that. But this is our contribution. I mean, and we're real happy on find getting some feedback on this and try it out and all those things. If this will have the name WHPP in the future, I don't know. I don't care. As soon as we have a standard, and I just want to move this forward.